Thank you so much for joining us for this conversation today on Women at the Forefront. I promise you that today I'm having an amazing guest with me in studio. She's a women rights activist, actually just an activist who has worked a lot in terms of fighting for the rights of people in the society. She's also an author, and also currently she is the CEC for Lands, Housing and Urban Development in Busia County, the county of Governor Sospeter Ojomong. I'm talking about none other than Honorable Bernadette Muyomi, who has joined me this morning on Women at the Forefront to talk about quite a number of issues that affect women, including women and land rights. We are going to be talking about the impact of war on women and the need to have peace each and every time in our communities. Thank you so much for joining me. Remember, you can be part of this conversation at @Safin_Ching. The hashtag is GMKKBC. And right about now, let me introduce my guest and give her a chance to say hello to my viewer.
Thank you, Safin. I'm delighted to be here this morning. Mm-hmm. Good morning, fellow Kenyans. I'm happy to be here. And just to say that I am non-apologetic about being a woman, because I did not choose to be a woman, and I have to live with it and live with it right. Thank you.
Wow, how do you describe a woman?
I describe a woman as a magnificent creation of God. I describe a woman as an inevitable part of human existence. Yes.
Okay, we are happy to have you, and thank you so much. Of course, you'll be sharing with us quite a lot about what you've been able to do for women and what we can do as a society to uplift women even more. And probably let's start by understanding where your journey into leadership began. Did it come to you, or did you seek leadership?
I cannot say that I sought leadership, because from the earliest point of my life, I have been a leader. Probably it is because I am a firstborn, so I had to start taking a leadership role right at the family level. Besides that, in school, I have always been in positions of leadership. And I have been in both formal and informal positions of leadership where I offer guidance, insights to friends, both older and younger than me, as well as peers.
Okay. And was there a time in that journey that you struggled with issues to do with identity, not knowing what really you want to do, trying to figure out what you were meant to do? Was there a time that you went through such an experience?
Yes, a lot of times I have gone through such moments. I can highlight one that is very vivid in my mind. I studied nursing in the university, but at the end of my training, I realized that that was not the kind of profession that was in tandem with my personality. And that triggered me to pursue a postgraduate in development studies and venture into other fields where I could speak up for people and I could use my creativity and my mind to foster change.
Okay, so it was a moment in your life you thought you were doing something, but then somewhere along the way you realized this was not your course.
No.
So you went into something else.
Exactly.
There are a lot of women who are watching you this morning, and they still struggle with that aspect of trying to identify who they are, what they were meant to be, what they are capable of. There's that, you know, conflict from within and conflict from the environment that they are in. They still do not know. We are talking about, you know, women empowerment. We are talking about all these opportunities that are there for women. But there is that one woman who is still asking, is it really possible for me? What's your message for that woman?
My message to such a woman is that the starting point is believing in yourself. It all starts inside you. Once you believe in yourself, you will be able to reach out to people who can support your cause. And it takes time and self-reflection, and also having people who can genuinely tell you about your strengths, your weaknesses, and your potentials, so that you're able to explore your capacity in full.
Okay, and also tell me, you, apart from being a leader, you are an activist as well, and these are two different things. At what point did you realize that you had that in you, and how did it start?
From the very first time when I started serving in a position of leadership, in top leadership to be precise, I was a CEO, a director of an organization back in 2008. And I, at that juncture, the organization was using a needs-based approach to programming. I was the first African and Kenyan director to the organization. And it made me realize that a needs-based approach is not what my community would benefit from. I was then forced to change the programming to a rights-based approach. Mm-hmm. And that made me realize that it is not just enough to work, but you must work to effect change. And then with time, I also came to realize that there are different forms of activism. For instance, right now, as I serve in the government, I cannot be an activist. Mm. I cannot be an activist. I have to be the person who is doing what everybody is demanding or wishing ought to be done.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So being in your role as an activist, when you had the opportunity to do that, probably what are some of the issues that were of concern for you, especially the ones that touch on the life of a woman mm-hmm. who is in Kenya today?
Mm-hmm. I was deeply disturbed by negative cultural practices, sexual insubordination and harassment of women, and the mere fact that women are ignorant of their basic rights as human beings, mm-hmm. let alone as women. Mm-hmm. Those things disturbed me, right from the issue of property ownership, the issue of access to resources, issues of decision making, mm-hmm. issues of being able to speak for yourself. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is it, I always like asking this question, is mm-hmm. it the woman who has failed and exposed herself to certain, you know, challenges, mm-hmm. or is it society that has imposed these hardships to the woman?
It is a cocktail of many issues, but more so society and a patriarchal society imposing these issues on women, because a woman who does not know what her rights are will not stand up for those rights. Mm-hmm. And I say this speaking from the experience of working with women, empowering them, and all of a sudden a woman says, I never knew that this was wrong. Mm-hmm. I did not know that someone was stepping on my toes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and currently you're the CEC of Lands and Housing in Urban Development in Busia County. I'm sure it's been a journey for you to get to where you are today, mm-hmm. because we live in a society where always we talk about these challenges and these bottlenecks that, you know, affect the rising of women in the society. But then here you are, and I believe you're still rising. Mm-hmm. There are more to come. And tell me a bit about how that, you know, was for you. What lessons can we gather from your process? What challenges did you meet along the way mm-hmm. that we can be able to learn from this morning?
Mm-hmm. First, I must appreciate the decision that my governor, Sospeter Ojaamong, made, because I think it is one thing to be a governor, a leader, and it's another thing not just to appoint women in positions of leadership, but also to recognize the roles that they play within the society. I started off in the departmental docket of public service and ICT, and that was a new department within mm-hmm. the county government. Thereafter, I moved to Lands, Housing and Urban Development. And I can say that the challenges are immense, yes, but not abnormal challenges. We as a woman, I still have to struggle to put forth ideas. Mm. I still yeah. have to ensure that despite serving the general public, the issues that affect women are incorporated in almost everything that I work. And apart from that, I have a personal and collective role among my female friends to mm-hmm. ensure that we also assist our male colleagues and stakeholders to understand the place and plight of women in society. Mm-hmm. And I say this because they may be willing to support the cause, but if they do not understand how women need this support, mm-hmm. it also becomes difficult for them to support us.
Mm-hmm. Women in the corporate world, are they fully represented, or is it picking up, or what is happening? Give us the picture from where you sit.
From where I sit, there is an increase in women's representation and even identification of women roles. One of the things I'm so grateful for through my appointment is that I wasn't assigned typical female roles mm. that allude to the fact that this is a role that suits you because you're a woman. Being in charge of Lands, Housing and Urban Development, mm. I work with both men and women.
Yeah,
but
true.
Clearly it is a male-dominated
field. And more so male,
field.
Because
yes.
we live in a patriarchal society. They believe land is... Mm-hmm. Basically, ownership is given to the man, priority is given to the man.
Exactly. Yeah. But I'm grateful that the new constitution provides for at least one-third of either gender to be represented in public bodies. Mm-hmm. And this creates the beginning of a narrative where women can start to claim their space in leadership. Mm-hmm. And often I say, as it's echoed, nobody can stop, not even the mightiest army, can stop an idea whose time has come. Mm-hmm. And at this time, it is time for women. The time for women has come. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about this strategy? You've talked about the one-third, you know, gender rule, and there has been a lot of that. And every company, society, even in government, we are seeing a lot of that happening, people trying to incorporate women into more positions. But mm-hmm. what do you think of this strategy of, aside from allocating women, you know, duties that are termed to be feminine, there's also that issue of, you know, let's nominate, let's just bring them on board, let's give them a softer landing as compared to men. Is that really effective in terms of the way you're saying that you sat, you gave ideas, you challenged, you did that, that is how you rose to your to where you are today? When a woman is given a softer landing, when a woman is seen to have been like she was given that opportunity on a silver platter, mm-hmm. is it really going to, is she going to be as effective as she is supposed to be in that position?
Mm-hmm. I tend to contradict on the fact that it is a silver platter, mm-hmm. because we are talking of coming from a society where women were not there. Mm-hmm. Then suddenly the forces within the law, the stage at which we are in society, allows them to be at the place where they are right now, in positions of leadership. Yeah. So while society may look at it like it is a given position, we must be cognizant of the struggles that women have gone through and realize that without that affirmative action, women would not be there. Mm-hmm. Let us give an example of the Kenyan political scenario. How many women were elected into the Senate? Zero. Mm-hmm. How many women are in the population of Kenya? More than 50% of mm-hmm. the population of Kenya is women. Mm-hmm. However, they are not elected because of other circumstances that revolve around financial constraints, traditional approach to women's leadership. And therefore, the issue of affirmative action is a boost to the story of women's leadership. Mm-hmm. And I don't consider it anything that comes with a silver platter, mm-hmm. because let us not look at women's role as only what they do on the forefront. Mm-hmm. Women play a lot of roles in the background, creating peace, building dialogues, and contributing in discussions that add value in a manner that many people may not be able to see. Mm-hmm. I give even a good example of the media. To what extent does the media profile women? Mm-hmm. And that alone is reason enough to say that nothing comes on a silver platter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How, in your view, how does media profile women? Where does media place women mm-hmm. today?
It varies, because I think it depends with the kind of approach mm-hmm. in terms of the background of, for example, the person behind the women's work. Mm-hmm. If you are conscious of the place of women, you will tend to bring out the stories of women. Okay. And also, you decide which stories are to be tagged on women. Mm-hmm. You can opt to have scandalous sexual stories, because it is common for gender shaming mm-hmm. to carry the story of the day mm-hmm. in any particular story. However, you can opt to showcase the positive things that women are doing in pushing for legislation, standing up for themselves and for others, and in causing transformative and sustainable change in different sectors mm-hmm. in the country.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the Constitution, which is also you know, one step that we've taken as a country to ensure that women are given these rights that they deserve. You're part of you know, the formation of the 2010 Constitution and civic education, and you, one of the responsibilities that you had was to make sure that the voice of a woman is heard during the entire process, and that they understood the Constitution and that they understood mm-hmm. their right. Mm-hmm. Tell us about that experience, and 7 years down the line, was it a worthy cause?
It was a worth cause, because I looked at it from the Convention of Elimination of All Forms Against of Domestic Violence and mm-hmm. all other forms of violence against women. And I think it is a great achievement that women in this country today are able to allude to specific rights courtesy of the new Constitution. Mm-hmm. When we talk about children's rights and women's rights that are being recognized, we have a Sexual Offences Act that you can use to defend yourself mm-hmm. in case of anything. We also have issues beyond what we may ordinarily look at specific to women. For example, protection to property, because these are issues that have enabled widows to be protected mm-hmm. from cultural atrocities. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. And on the same note, the same constitution also provides for public participation mm-hmm. in issues to do with what is happening in our society and in our governments. Mm-hmm. Do we see more women speaking out when things happen? Do we see them come out and speak? Mm-hmm. Or women still believe that they take, you know, the back seat and they tend to like, they don't have much of a loud voice when it comes to certain issues. Where do we fall today?
It varies from one society to another. My caution, however, has been on the fact that the arena and space for women needs to be broadened beyond specific women. So that when we talk about women leaders and women who can speak about issues, it should be a whole range of women. Unlike what I commonly see today, where you find the woman businessman is the woman religious leader, she's the woman, for example, political representative. Mm-hmm. So we need to ensure that more women speak so that the voices of more people are brought on board. Mm-hmm. And I think it's quite an improvement, just looking at it even from our own county governments and settings. Mm-hmm. We have public participation forums that are open to the public.
Mm-hmm. And but when you talk of public, mm-hmm. Are women really represented in this public that we talk about? Do they really come out and speak?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Increasingly, women are coming out to speak, but again, it goes back to the issue of awareness. Are they aware of the specific issues they need to be speaking on? Are they able to relate the development discourse to their own needs? Mm-hmm. And when I talk about relating the development discourse, I like to cite the issue of health facilities, water access points, and ask, do these women opt for this as the needs for their need in development? Mm-hmm. Because they feel that it, for example, the water points reduce their unpaid care work burden? Mm-hmm. Do they contribute to say they want a health facility because they think it is going to resolve mm-hmm. maternal health issues? Mm-hmm. Or do they do it because generally a hospital is good, mm-hmm. generally people need to have water? So for me, the level of consciousness to which they engage mm-hmm. is what needs to be improved. However, there is already effort to see women engage more in public spaces.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we'll see that and how far that goes. And I'll come back to that mm-hmm. voice of a woman mm-hmm. again later in the course of this conversation. But let's talk about women and land rights. Mm-hmm. In the docket that you hold right now, there are so many issues that revolve around land, and there are so many issues evolving around women and land. So let's talk about that a bit. Mm-hmm. Land as we speak today, who is ideally the person who should own land as we speak today?
Everybody can own land mm-hmm. and nobody is more ideal than the other to own. Mm-hmm. From a minor to a woman, mm-hmm. a youth, a person with disability, everybody should and can own land.
Mm-hmm. Mm. But is that the case that we experience today?
Not really, because we are looking at coming from a strongly patriarchal society where we are ancestral land is passed to the male child. But this is increasingly changing with levels of awareness where you see families share and distribute their land among all the children, sometimes equally, sometimes not equally. Mm-hmm. But we cannot run away from the fact that women are still marginalized and disadvantaged when it comes to ownership of land.
Mm-hmm. Mm. What are some of the key issues that affect women, challenges that you would say mm-hmm. women are still battling with when it comes to land ownership in Kenya?
Mm-hmm. One of the key issues is ownership. Mm-hmm. They may own the land, but they may not own it legally in the sense that they may not have processed their titles, mm-hmm. not because they do not want to. Sometimes they cannot afford it. Sometimes they are not aware that full ownership means having title to the land. Mm-hmm. The other issue may be on decision making in terms of how they use that land. Mm-hmm. You may find a woman married in a home. Yes, she's there. Her husband could be deceased or alive, but she does not have a say on what the land is used, mm-hmm. is used on. And then we look at the issue of how women utilize land to support their families. And then look at how financial institutions, for example, mm-hmm. give loans without consideration of whether the voice of the woman is included in that discussion or mm-hmm. decision or not, mm-hmm. unless where it is clearly indicated that a woman co-owns the piece of land. However, that should not be restricted to that only, because we are all aware of the role that women play as traditional and primary producers, mm-hmm. and using land as a basic factor of production.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You come from, just allow me to use this as an example. You come, yes. from Busia County, mm-hmm. the western region, mm-hmm. one of the regions that believed to be having a lot of polygamy setups. Mm-hmm. And this also affects women when it comes to land. We've seen a lot of battles and a lot of issues that surround that. Mm-hmm. Probably give us a picture back in your area, or mm-hmm. just a general view of how the society is. Mm-hmm. The issue of polygamy, how mm-hmm. best should we handle this when it comes to ensuring that the right of a woman to own land is observed?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is about empowering women more, and also recognizing the current laws that help to protect women land rights and women's property rights. Mm-hmm. One of them is the Marriage Act. And in this case, I think that it is a responsibility that women need to take up as much as men, because in a polygamous setting, a man will know to what extent which wife has contributed to which property. Mm-hmm. And it can be, in some situations, it is very clear who owns what. But the mere fact that this is never articulated early enough, until probably someone has died, is mm-hmm. when you start seeing the wrangles, is what creates the problem. And also the fact that it is, in the recent past, it is rare that you will find polygamy happening like it happened in our traditional setting. Mm-hmm. Today, most people just wake up and find themselves in a polygamous marital setup. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And like in the past, where it was clear that a new wife yeah. has been brought home, mm-hmm. and therefore, issues of property
and you could be consulted
exactly
before it happens,
and
yeah.
land could mm-hmm. be articulated on time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's still a challenge. That
yes.
But mm-hmm. you know, when you talk of polygamy, patriarchy, these are aspects of our culture that we value, mm-hmm. that are not going anywhere, mm-hmm. and culture is here to stay. Mm-hmm. But then again, how do we deal with it? How do we change the narrative? Mm-hmm. Even as we talk about, you know, fighting for women to get more spaces in land ownership, mm-hmm. how do we deal with the issue of culture the best way possible, so that the men will feel like they have their space, mm-hmm. the women will also feel like they have their space at mm-hmm. the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One way is to make men key players in the push for women's rights and the realization of women's dignity. Mm-hmm. The issue of promoting women's rights is not a competition or a battle between men and women. Mm-hmm. It is supposed to be a collaborative process that brings into consciousness that these are atrocities that must be addressed. That is the first thing. Mm-hmm. The second thing, when you look at our communities, most people are ignorant of their own rights. So we must also consciously go out of our way to use every opportunity that we have to share information. And thirdly, I think that showcasing success stories gives a lot of women confidence to be able to stand up for themselves. Because mm-hmm. if you are a woman on your own, you may feel that it is right for you to stand up for yourself, but deep inside you wonder whether it is really possible, and it is until you listen to the success story of somebody else mm-hmm. that you will be able to gain the confidence to stand up for yourself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So engage men in the process.
Yes.
That is one thing I take home, because mm-hmm. that is very important, even as we talk about women empowerment. If mm-hmm. it is all women mm-hmm. drumming up support for themselves, mm-hmm. at the end of the day, mm-hmm. the men are left out. Then who are you campaigning? Mm-hmm. Who are you addressing? Mm-hmm. Where did the problem start? Mm-hmm. I agree with you on the part of, you know, bring the men on board mm-hmm. and make it a conversation that the whole community is involved in. Mm-hmm. And probably when the negotiations fail, when there is no mutual understanding and mutual agreement, the mm-hmm. only thing that we all rely on as citizens is the law. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the law and what role it has played in protecting women and land rights. Do you mm-hmm. think they have been effective, or there is still a gap that needs to be filled?
Mm-hmm. It is a process, but so far we are moving in the right direction, mm-hmm. because the mere fact that a woman can walk into a court of law, put an injunction on a property she finds has a dispute, and a caveat is put on that property, mm-hmm. is enough for us to say that where a woman is conscious of her space and mm-hmm. her rights, mm-hmm. she is able to reap the benefits of the law. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, we are increasingly seeing a more transparent judicial service. Mm-hmm. It is my hope and anticipation that the reforms will be able to improve to a point that the ordinary person finds like the court is a space mm-hmm. they can run to mm-hmm. in case of anything. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, there are many provisions in the law, and it is not restrictive. Mm-hmm. Today, almost all laws are written in very simple terms. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you don't even need a lawyer to go and stand up for you in many cases. Mm-hmm. And this alone is a gain that women can ride on.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So then, as we're about to, you know, leave the issue of land aside, mm-hmm. What do you advise women to do in terms of how they can be able to guard themselves and protect themselves against, you know, infringement of their rights when it comes to land? What do we need to do or know mm-hmm. as we move forward?
Yes, the first thing is what we really need to know is in terms of the process of land ownership. Mm-hmm. So that as we own land or as we use land, we must also struggle to ensure that the ownership is in our name. Mm. And if not in our name, in our control. I say this because owning land means many other things. For example, production. Yeah. It also means access to financial resources mm-hmm. where you may need a title to secure your land. Mm-hmm. You may use a title in a court of law. Mm-hmm. You may use a title to offset mm-hmm. a hospital bill or at least have your patient mm-hmm. released from hospital. True. So mm-hmm. it means many things. And the starting point is to understand the process and make a deliberate effort to go through the process and ensure that you own the land fully. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And the docket that you are in, it's an open docket that you address both genders. But again, yes. What have you done that is sensitive to the needs of women in this area of land? What mm-hmm. have you done to ensure that at least you play your role in helping the woman mm-hmm. get her rights at the end of the day? Mm-hmm.
Key to me is the articulation to women that there is opportunity for them to be assisted mm-hmm. and just sharing basic information with women. I also make it aware to my colleagues and people that I'm able to influence within my own work environment to acknowledge the uniqueness and challenges that women face. And through this acknowledgement, they are able to help women. For instance, I will say that it is easier for a woman to come and follow up land issues on a market day because she has also come to the market. Mm-hmm. Being conscious of the role that a woman plays in that small community helps you to give her appointments that are in line with what supports her day-to-day life activities. Mm-hmm. And it also helps you to recognize the fact that she may be limited in terms of decision making mm-hmm. and you have a role or I have a role to ensure that despite not being conscious of what needs to be done, mm-hmm. that she is not shortchanged of her rights.
Okay.
Yes.
Well said. And that is the issue of land, of course. Mm-hmm. And there is more that still needs to be done to
yes.
ensure that mm-hmm. we realize the dream of making sure that there is fairness and equality when it comes to women and land. Mm-hmm. And let's talk about something else. Mm-hmm. Right now, there is a lot that is happening around messages of peace being passed around as we go to the general elections. We have differences politically, but the country does not want to go back to where we were in 2007. 2008, you were part of a process that mm-hmm. Was geared towards helping women, especially from Mount Elgon, a region that was worst hit, to go back to normal and you know, move on with their lives after so much that they went through after the post-election violence. Talk to us today. What are some of the consequences that affect women specifically when it comes to these communal conflicts, these wars that we see a lot happening? How are women affected? You know, society thinks it's only the men who are at risk because they go out there to fight. But how are women affected with this?
Thank you, Safin. In 2008, I met several members of a community from Mount Elgon. Mm-hmm. And my heart bled when I listened to the kind of atrocities that they had faced during the skirmishes. And that triggered me to found an organization alongside this community. It's called United Friends of Mount Elgon. We looked at how we can play a role mm-hmm. in never allowing any other human being to undergo what they went through. There is no monopoly in war, And that is what people forget. Yeah. That while the men may be on the forefront of fighting, the negative effects and the hugest burden of the war is on women. Mm-hmm. When children are left orphaned, women are raped and give birth to children whose fathers they do not know. Mm-hmm. That is traumatizing. And trauma can live with them for a number of years. Mm-hmm. And worse off, when we talk about war and address some of these challenges, sometimes we tend to focus on the immediate needs and forget that the psychological impact of war can be life-threatening, and it can live in a person for as long as they live. Mm-hmm. So it is my hope that as we continue to engage in the political discourse, we increasingly realize that first, there is no monopoly in war. So you cannot be on the forefront of doing anything that can trigger a war. Mm-hmm. And a war can start at any time and in any way. Mm-hmm. There is no formula on how wars start. And therefore, everybody must take a very conscious role in what they do in terms of their articulations, their convictions, and even what they motivate people to do. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What's your message to our leaders and probably as Wananchi? What, as a preventive approach, what do we need to be aware of at this point in time? Mm-hmm. What do we need to do so that we ensure that even if we have differences, mm-hmm, of, you know, ideas, mm-hmm, it doesn't get physical?
Mm-hmm. Mm. That's a good one. The first thing is to the citizens. We need to realize that when all is said and done, politicians converge and their brothers and sisters, that we do not have major differences, mm-hmm, as human beings. Mm-hmm. We may have physical differences, language differences, but at the end of the day, we share humanity. And it is very unfortunate if we as citizens and followers of political leaders can disadvantage our own lives at the expense of generations. Mm-hmm. And to the politicians, it is irresponsible and uncouth that a politician rides on war in order to thrive. Therefore, every leader should push for peaceful coexistence, not because peaceful coexistence is the in thing, not because women and children will suffer, but simply because it is human to propel peaceful coexistence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, when we are talking about conflict, mm-hmm, and the effect of conflict on women, mm-hmm, children, mm-hmm, I remembered about the drought situation that we've also experienced. Mm-hmm. The women are the worst affected. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, it's the baby will come to the mom to, mm-hmm, ask for food. Mm-hmm. They don't care whether the food, mm-hmm, where the food is going to come from, mm-hmm, but they just want food. Mm-hmm. When we go to our supermarkets and the food prices have gone up, the most affected gender is the woman, because, mm-hmm, she's the one who is going shopping. She's the one who is realizing how suddenly things have become double price. And there's so much that is happening that is affecting the woman. Mm-hmm. But when I go back to the issue of that voice, that speaking out, I don't see a lot of women coming out in public and even calling press conferences to address even the issue of increased food prices, because this is an issue that affects our kitchen, it affects our homes. We've come out as women to speak, or about the drought situation, or about the war. I don't see women coming together as women, as a bloc, to talk about these issues. Probably, mm-hmm, where do you think we are missing the point? Why is this happening?
My thinking is that everybody seems to be feeling the problem and equally waiting for somebody else to do something about it. Mm. We don't realize that it is our individual responsibility to try and input on whatever change that needs to happen.
Yeah.
Because indeed, it is a burden to women. When you look at the drought, for instance, mm, it worsens the
unpaid. It is the woman who walks long distances.
Care work, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm, go ahead.
Oh, yes, sorry. So I think that we are letting somebody else, or assuming that somebody else will speak up for us, mm-hmm, and nobody is really speaking up to us. So it's probably a challenge to women that we need to speak up on these issues increasingly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, so as you're about to bring this conversation to a close, mm-hmm, right now you're saying you're not fully an activist because of the docket that you hold, but, mm, if there are people out there who are champions of women's rights, who really, really want to push this agenda forward, what are some of the key areas of concern that you think they should focus on, that you think they need really to put weight on to address that are affecting a woman in Kenya today?
Mm-hmm. First and foremost is a call to ensure that we make men key players and partners in whatever change we want to see for women. As I said initially, it is not a battle or a competition of the sexes, but rather a collaborative process for the improvement of general humanity. Therefore, in everything we endeavor to do, let us bring men on board, because they will be better partners if they understand how else they can help us to achieve our rights. Secondly, is to urge that whenever we are pushing for women's issues, we need to create meaningful partnerships. We need to understand the mindsets and the thought processes of those who step on women's rights.
Mm-hmm.
Why do they behave the way they do?
Mm-hmm.
And often we go out on our activism without focusing on why other people behave.
Mm-hmm.
And through understanding the behavioral processes, we are able to have more impact. And then of course, being conscious that every moment is a moment to articulate women's issues and to propel the place of women in society. It does not have to be a situation. Activism does not have to be a situation where you're constantly on the streets, constantly carrying banners. It could be a silent, deliberate effort to ensure that women's issues are factored in literally everything that happens across different sectors, be it in the energy sector, agricultural sector, education, and many others.
Okay.
Yes.
And there's a lot, of course, that is happening to keep the conversation going.
Mm-hmm.
But let's borrow from you. Mm-hmm. You've traveled a lot of countries. You've attended many forums and even leadership forums.
Mm-hmm.
And I always have a problem with the issue when we talk about women empowerment, and we come up with a lot of good paperwork in these forums, in these conferences, and we say a lot about what we are going to do, but there is less activity and less implementation of these issues that we address when we go for these forums.
Mm-hmm.
What lessons have you brought home? What are some of the things that you personally have done that are active enough that you can tell today that this is what I learned and this is what I did for women in my area, in my region?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was not paperwork.
Thank you very much. I'm lucky indeed, as you say, Safin, to have traveled quite widely and interacted with different women across the globe.
Mm-hmm.
And in all this, I have learned one thing: walk the talk. When I say walk the talk, it is because I've been privileged to meet amazing women who are doing work that may not be known in the entire world, but when all is said and done, it has a positive impact in the little communities that they come from.
Yeah.
I have met a lady who works in the media in Nepal.
Mm-hmm.
She runs a program called Story Kitchen, where she articulates women issues, and that's the first program of its kind from Nepal.
Mm-hmm.
So she's walking her talk in a simple way.
Mm-hmm.
I have met a woman who is from Zambia, who is focusing on children in prisons. She is walking her talk in her own little way.
Mm-hmm.
Back here in Kenya, I decided to walk my talk too.
Mm-hmm.
I am a founder of an organization called Green Agri Ventures, or famously known as the Green Bank. I founded this organization inspired by the global discourse of climate change, which I have been a part of as a result of my travels. And I looked at climate change from the angle of women. To what extent can women contribute to climate change?
Mm-hmm.
It is not enough to talk about red air emissions, when a local woman cannot even translate
understand
that
what it is
in her local vernacular.
It's true.
And I said, let me come up with an initiative that the local woman can benefit, and at the same time it will contribute to the global discourse of what needs to be done at this time.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Green Bank, as it's popularly known, is an initiative that supports smallholder farmers to specifically grow fruit trees. I'm very specific about fruit trees because I know that where number one, a woman can use the smallest piece of land to grow fruit trees.
Mm-hmm.
It can be her fence, and she can harvest And whatever she harvests can be eaten by her children, and some can be sold. Mm-hmm. And by planting these fruit trees, she is growing trees. Mm-hmm. And therefore, she is contributing towards climate change mitigation. Mm-hmm. And apart from that, it is putting money on her table. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. I looked at this concept as one that empowers the local woman. Mm-hmm. I have two models for it. One is the Fruits for Wealth, which I have just highlighted. Mm-hmm. Another one is Fruits for Books. We all know that today, the girl child in Kenya, in most rural communities that mm-hmm. are living in poverty, is at disadvantage because they cannot access sanitary towels. Mm-hmm. So in the Fruits for Books initiative, the girl child, through the school system, is empowered to grow fruit trees. And this is a collaboration that also includes young boys so that they can start understanding mm. that it
Bring
is time,
the process,
yes,
yeah.
they appreciate yeah. what girls and women go through, okay. and hopefully they will grow with this. Mm-hmm. So through this initiative, the sales from the fruits are used to buy sanitary towels, and I find this to be sustainable mm-hmm. than going to borrow sanitary towels every
wow.
day.
Wow.
You have a source, and in the process, the students have learned some entrepreneurial skills, they have learned some agricultural mm-hmm. skills, mm-hmm. and above all, we have uplifted the dignity of the girl child
wow.
and enabled her to access education. And mm-hmm. because one harvest is enough to produce sanitary towels for a whole year, the rest of the money is used to buy books to stock libraries mm-hmm. that are used by all children, mm-hmm. and this reduces the cost of education to the parent at home.
Okay.
So I am walking the talk.
So an example of how you decided to walk the talk.
Yes.
Very well said.
Mm-hmm.
And we are in the journey to mm-hmm. realize the mm-hmm. a society where women can really feel that they are taking their space.
Mm-hmm.
But among the many challenges that are facing women, one of the challenges that you see as a person is devolution.
Mm-hmm.
You saw it as a challenge
mm-hmm.
to, you know, women's progress in terms of achieving their rights. Tell me more about that. How is devolution really making this journey tougher?
I really think I think it is both a challenge and an opportunity.
Okay.
This is how I look at it as a challenge. When we talk about devolution, we are talking about more localized communities that share similar cultures. It is easier for a man in such a community to tell a woman, this is not what we do in our community.
Yeah.
This is not the kind of position you ought to take.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't have spoken before consulting your husband.
Mm-hmm.
The same cannot be told to you in a different community where you don't specifically share the same cultural
mm-hmm.
Background with people.
Mm-hmm.
And this will be seen even in communities that are predominantly male.
Mm-hmm.
You will see that women are not being fronted for top leadership positions,
mm-hmm.
like positions of governors
mm-hmm.
and senators. And then I see it as an opportunity because devolution offers a chance for more women at the grassroots
mm-hmm.
to exhibit their leadership capacity.
Mm-hmm.
I look at it from a classic example in Busia County. We have many opportunities where women have been incorporated to showcase their leadership.
Mm-hmm.
I will start with the county executive. There are three female members of the county executive.
Mm-hmm.
We have female chief officers. The chairperson of the county public service board
mm-hmm.
was a woman. Unfortunately, she passed on, but
mm-hmm.
God rest her soul in peace.
Mm-hmm.
And we have other platforms, the town management committees. We have two in Busia. One is chaired by a woman. That is progress. We have the education board,
mm-hmm.
the cooperative management board, the water services board. These are small but powerful and meaningful spaces where women at the grassroots can start
mm-hmm.
to exhibit their leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And the opportunity that devolution offers is that all of a sudden, Kenya is going to realize that there are so many women who are capable of leading
mm-hmm.
in different capacities
mm-hmm.
because of devolution.
Okay, so it's mm-hmm. double.
Yes.
It's two-sided.
Yes, but
there
of
are challenges,
mm-hmm.
but there are also opportunities
yes.
that women can take advantage of.
Yes, and of course the opportunities are greater than any challenges we could speak about.
All right.
Yes.
So as we bring this to a close, your mm-hmm. final words on the conversation that we've had today and probably
mm-hmm.
your vision for women in Kenya.
Mm-hmm. First is to urge and encourage that we should not be restricted by thinking that we are women mm-hmm. and so we may not make it. Somebody can make it from whichever part of the globe they're in.
Okay.
And I always give myself as a classical example. I have never lived in any capital city of any country, but I am also proud to say that I am globally recognized mm-hmm. among various networks. So it is not where we are that defines where we ought to be. It is about the will and the motivation, your personal conviction to become part of the global world.
Mm-hmm.
Today the world is a global village.
Mm-hmm.
And so whether I am in Busia or in New York
mm-hmm.
or in Australia,
mm-hmm.
we need to keep doing what we must do.
Mm-hmm.
And we must do it with confidence. Nobody's going to wake up and tell us, it is now time for you to start leading.
Mm-hmm.
You must start leading with the earliest opportune moment. Let us not shy away from leadership.
Mm-hmm.
If you're called upon to chair a meeting, take that as a serious leadership
mm-hmm.
role.
Mm-hmm.
Start right there.
Mm-hmm.
If you're asked to give a vote of thanks, take that as an opportunity of leadership. Don't wait for a big moment, because we have to start walking small journeys before we finally say we have walked a journey of mm-hmm. 1,000 miles.
Wow. Mm. Well said. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah.
And as you go back to Busia, take mm-hmm. our greetings. I'm going to talk to Masalamu. You know, I have to give you that opportunity to, lest the people won't forgive me. You know, people from Western like sending shout out.
Thank you, Safin. I send my shout out and my greetings to all the people of Busia. I value you, I respect you, and I am what I am today because of the contribution of all your efforts. Thank you.
Thank you so much for mm-hmm. your time. And of course, I always say, mm-hmm. a woman is like a tea bag.
Mm-hmm.
You don't realize her power until you place her in hot water. And you know mm-hmm. what the hot water is? It mm-hmm. is those challenges.
Yes.
It is those hardships that come your way.
Mm-hmm.
So you may never know what you're capable of and what you are you can possibly do until you face that hardship.
Mm-hmm.
So embrace yourself, go out there and do your thing. Always wake up and show up. My name is Safin Acheng. This is Women at the Forefront. We do this again next Tuesday. A different guest, a different topic, but the same host, same set. Keep it right here. There is more coming your way.